Penguin Random House Audio presents Avid Reader, A Life by Robert Gottlieb. Read by the author.
Epigraph. From the introduction to The Story of a Wonder Man, being the autobiography of Ring Lardner. By the employment of methods amounting almost to the so-called third degree, the heads of the publisher syndicate, who I am under contract, has finally got me to write my autobiography, a task which I shrink from it like Pola Negri from a camera, yet which the doing of which I feel I owe it to my public. Note. For a long time, when people asked me whether I was ever going to write a memoir or autobiography, I answered that all editors' memoirs basically come down to the same thing. And then I said, Leo, don't just do war, do peace too. For various reasons. I wanted to set bits of the record straight. I wanted to say some things about editing and publishing and even myself. I eventually changed my mind and have, to my chagrin, discovered the inevitability of the Tolstoy syndrome. There was no way I could talk about editing and publishing except in terms of the books I myself had worked on. So it all comes down to I did this and I did that, and naturally it's one's successes one tends to remember, as with Leo. Reading. I began as I would go on, reading. By the time I was 4, my grandfather had shown me how to do it, mostly by having me follow along as he read to me. My mother, a New York City public school teacher, left for work early every morning. But Grandpa, her father, who lived with us until he died when I was 9, was always there, and after breakfast I would climb into his bed, and he would tell me stories, teach me chess, and read aloud. Most important were Kipling's Jungle Books, and I still have the 2 volumes, one bound in mustard, one in green, that he read from, and which thrilled me. But before that was Dorothy Cunard's Junket is Nice, which came into the world in 1933, 2 years after I did, and which I couldn't get enough of. Later she would write the indispensable Pat the Bunny. Although it was a success, Junket is Nice disappeared, not just my copy, but altogether. Apparently there were legal problems with the Junket people, and only recently has it been restored to us. Going back to it after more than 75 years, I discovered that it's about a little boy who turns out to be smarter than anyone else in the world. What a surprise that I needed constant access to it. The next book to seize me totally was read to our 4th grade class by nice, motherly Mrs. Hurst. It was Lad, a Dog by Albert Payson Terhune, and dogs were my passion. But Lad was not a dog like my cute little Waggy. Lad was a collie and, a recurrent Terhune theme, a thoroughbred. Albert Payson Terhune did not care for mongrels, in fact was a devoted eugenicist. The burglar whom Lad routs in the middle of the night is unsurprisingly a Negro. But what did I know about eugenics? Lad was noble, Lad was true. As I discovered on a recent rereading, among his many exploits, Lad saved the life of a 5-year-old paralyzed girl by flinging himself between her and a striking copperhead, not only almost dying from snake venom, but somehow prompting the child to walk. I already love dogs, so much easier to deal with than other children. And Lad was not just any dog, as we learn in the first paragraph. He had the gay courage of D'Artagnan and an uncanny wisdom. Also, who could doubt it after a look into his mournful brown eyes? He had a soul. I tried not to show I was crying during Mrs. Hurst's read-alouds. Lad, a Dog went through 70 printings in its original edition, and Terhune went on to write at least 30 other dog books, many of which I read, and all of which I assume displayed the mawkish Terhune style and reflected the repulsive Terhune beliefs. But it was Lad that revealed to me the amazing power of books to arouse feelings and therefore to change lives. I was emotionally prepared when Eric Knight's Lassie Come Home, the movie dropped the hyphen, came my way, an infinitely better book than Lad, which I think I recognized even then. Horse books didn't get to me, not even Black Beauty, although I liked and still like Mary O'Hara's Flicka trilogy. But it was their boy hero, Ken, with whom I identified, not the horses. Of course, I also read the established children's classics. Alice, The Wind in the Willows, Tom Sawyer, Jules Verne, all the Oz books and Dr. Dolittle books, as well as the more recent ones, especially the inevitable Winnie the Poohs. There were also adventure series, which I could take out from the public library in batches of three or four. Tarzan, naturally, and a successful rip-off series I liked even more, the only title of which I remember being Bumba the Jungle Boy in the Swamp of Death, which I haven't revisited. The key books of my childhood, though, and sometimes I think of my entire life, were the 12 novels by Arthur Ransom, beginning with Swallows and Amazons, published in 1930, just in time for me. The Swallows were the four Walker children, the Amazons were the two Blackett girls, and they took their aliases from the two little boats that sailed in the summers on the author's reimagining of Lake Windermere in England's Lake District. In the fourth book, Winter Holiday, they're joined by the two Callum children, Dick, a budding scientist, and Dorothea, a novelist in waiting. These two were the characters I felt closest to. Bookish, shy loners, they were the outsiders who were swept up by the Swallows and Amazons and joined in their adventures. I was certainly not an adventurer and didn't want to be one, so it wasn't the sailing, the camping out, the racing, or the gentle plots that called to me. It was that community of decent, independent youngsters, superbly individualized by Ransom, trusted by their parents, enjoying a healthy childhood, having fun. If the Walkers and the Blacketts could adopt the Callums, they might have made room for me. Over a period of 4 or 5 years, I read and reread and re-reread the Ransom books, my favorites as many as 50 times each. They were the counterpoint to school, homework, playing cards with my parents, and occasionally chess with my father, the only activity we shared, typical nighttime phone calls with classmates, and radio, the essential entertainment of the period. Since I was sickly, though not as sickly as I made myself out to be, I was home from school a lot, caught up in radio soap operas, Our Gal Sunday, the story of an orphaned mountain girl married to Lord Henry Brinthrop, England's richest, most handsome lord. Life Can Be Beautiful, the story of the waif Chichi Conrad, who one day stumbles into benign Papa David Solomon's slightly red bookshop where she takes up permanent residence along with the embittered, crippled Stephen. Mary Marlin, theme song Clair de Lune, in which the heroine, when her husband, Senator Joe Marlin, disappears while on a secret mission to Siberia, becomes senator in his stead. And let's not forget Ma Perkins, Stella Dallas, based on the immortal novel by Olive Higgins Prouty, and the quintessential romance of Helen Trent, who, when life mocks her, breaks her hopes, dashes her against the rocks of despair, fights back bravely, successfully, to prove what so many women long to prove, that because a woman is 35 or more, romance in life need not be over. Helen Trent broadcast for 27 years. I assume that all this sentimental radio melodrama helped prepare me for my later immersion, both as reader and as editor, in genre fiction. It was certainly harmless stuff, since nothing bad or nasty ever really happened, except for the offstage disappearance of Senator Joe and the inevitable episodes involving either amnesia or trial for murder or both, that punctuated the lives of Sunday, Chichi, and the rest. When in the early 1950s, home from Cambridge, I dropped back in on soap opera, just in time to hear the final episode of Life Can Be Beautiful, everything had changed. Alcoholism, abortion, and adultery had barged in. The charm was gone, and the soaps were migrating to TV. Soap opera was a special taste. Nighttime radio was for everyone. Jack Benny, Bob Hope, Red Skelton, Fibber McGee and Molly, George Burns and Gracie Allen, Eddie Cantor, Fred Allen, Bing Crosby, Your Hit Parade, Information Please, Fanny Bryce as Baby Snooks were as pervasive as today's top TV shows, more so since there were fewer options. The big fight with your parents was whether you could have the radio on while you were doing your homework. They didn't realize that you were also doing your homework in the late afternoons while tuned in to the kid shows, Captain Midnight, Little Orphan Annie, and my special passion, Jack Armstrong, All American Boy. Another adventurer, often to be found deep in the Amazon jungles, and also embedded in a family not his own, his sidekicks Billy and Betty and their uncle Jim. Annie was by definition an orphan, as were Tarzan and Kipling's Mowgli. More deracinated than any of these was my hero of heroes, the Lone Ranger, who not only needed no one in his life other than the faithful Tonto and the great horse Silver, but was hidden behind a mask. I was also lucky enough to have been in on the birth and early exploits of the comic book heroes Superman and Batman, also more or less loners, also masked, and also omnipotent. Comic books were anathema to parents. Their brutality, pow, wham, and the desperate struggles of their heroes with avatars of evil, presumably luring us middle-class kids into lives of violence, if not crime. All in all, it was a sweet popular culture, from the anodyne pop music to the daily funnies, which I didn't get to see since the New York Times didn't run any and it was the only paper we got. So no Popeye, no Dick Tracy, no Lil Abner, and almost no movies, although Disney's Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs, released when I was 7, was traumatic for me. I lay awake at night terrified by the ravishingly beautiful and murderous Queen. There were also our household's two essential magazines, Life and The New Yorker. Even the national sport, baseball, which I followed eagerly, was benign.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.